Hello, I'm Elliott Antman, President of the American Heart Association, here for HA Science News at the European Society of Cardiology Congress in sunny Barcelona. We're here to discuss Hotline 4, treatments for acute myocardial infarction. And I'm pleased to be joined by Dr. Mark Creager, President-elect of the American Heart Association. So there were five trials that were discussed in Hotline 4. Two of them dealt with catheter-based interventions, and three of them dealt with medical supportive therapy for management of patients with myocardial infarction. So, Mark, let's turn first to the CvLPRIT study, a very interesting study that addressed the question as to whether or not, in the modern era, there was some value in attempting to intervene on lesions other than the ones in the infarct-related artery. So the question here was, primary PCI of the infarct-related artery alone versus multivessel PCI, if it was appropriate. It turned out that this was a very positive study favoring the multivessel group. It was a small study, but there was quite a signal of benefit there. And most interesting to me was the fact that there was no signal of harm, because in the past, one of the reasons that we recommended against intervening on something other than the infarct artery was a concern about creating havoc and creating harm. What are your thoughts about intervening in the acute situation of multivessel PCI?
Well, based on this trial, I would now be encouraged to move forward in that direction, because indeed the patient did better when the infarct-related artery and other affected arteries that were significantly stenosed in these patients were intervened upon. They had better long-term outcome, and if you think about it, this would lead to greater efficiency of care if we did everything at one sitting.
Absolutely.
And of course, our concerns before in doing everything at one sitting, would that cause more harm? This trial showed that it did not.
They did use a composite endpoint of the death, myocardial infarction, and ischemia-driven revascularization. And of interest, each of the elements of that composite endpoint was reduced proportionately about the same degree.
Exactly.
So it was an interesting question that arose as to whether or not we should immediately change the guidelines. And of course, we need to think through this a bit more and understand why it appeared so safe to do multivessel PCI now compared to the concerns that were raised in the past. That's an unsettled question, and I'm sure members of the writing committees for guidelines will have to face that. Let's talk about the next study, which was the FAMOUS study. And this looked at patients with non-ST elevation myocardial infarction. And they compared two approaches to management in the cath lab. One was the conventional approach, which was to perform an angiogram and evaluate the stenosis and move ahead based upon that. And the other approach was to use fractional flow reserve, or FFR, to determine what the physiologic significance was of a particular lesion to determine whether or not it should be intervened upon. They found that when they supplied the operator with the FFR data, a substantial proportion of patients actually were allocated to medical therapy, and there was a marked reduction, as you can imagine, in costs, and the quality of life was quite good in those individuals. So, Mark, what is FFR teaching us, and why is it something that appeared to be quite helpful here?
Well, Elliott, no surprise with this study. We're comparing a subjective measurement, which is a visual estimate of severity of stenosis, versus an objective, quantifiable physiologic measurement, and using the latter to really guide therapy. And in this case, it was there was a tendency towards improvement in the patients who did have fractional flow reserve measurements. And it's interesting, if you take this study in context with one published today in the New England Journal of Medicine by the FAME-2 investigators, which looked at patients with stable coronary artery disease, comparing FFR used to do PCI versus optimal medical therapy, again, in patients with stable coronary artery disease, those patients did better in terms of long-term cardiovascular outcomes.
So a number of bits of evidence now accumulating, suggesting that FFR might be a useful addition to the way we approach things in the cath lab. I did ask the operators, the investigators in this study, how long it took them to do the FFR in the cath lab, and they said it was about 10 minutes. Now let's turn our attention to three studies about medical supportive therapy for acute myocardial infarction. One of them was the NOMI study, and this was an inhalation of nitric oxide in an attempt to diminish reperfusion injury. And that was essentially a negative study. Any thoughts about why nitric oxide might have worked initially when you think about it, but it was completely negative in this study? Then the issue about a subgroup that they found for those who were naive to nitroglycerin. Where are we with this?
Well, there's lots of reasons to believe, Elliott, that nitric oxide would be a benefit in many situations. Nitric oxide, obviously a molecule released by the endothelium endogenously, but in this case given by an inhaled technique, could potentially improve endothelial function, reduce oxidative stress, and perhaps even reduce the risk of tissue death. So the thought behind the study was very rational. Unfortunately, it didn't work. The patients received inhaled nitric oxide, 80 parts per minute, versus not receiving that, and unfortunately there was no either biochemical indicator or MRI indicator of preservation of the infarcted tissue.
They raised this interesting question about a subgroup interaction with subjects who were naive to nitroglycerin seeming to actually have benefit from inhaled NO. Did that sway you?
No, actually not at all. That's a very problematic subsequent to the study analysis, if you will. It turns out that there was a difference in the groups who received the controlled administration versus the inhaled nitroglycerin when divided to those who received parenteral or sublingual nitroglycerin during the catheterization. And the difference was in those who had received nitroglycerin during the catheterization parenterally, they had lower infarct damage compared to those who did not. Mm-hmm. So when you compare the two groups, those who received control and those who received inhaled nitroglycerin, there's actually regression.
So inhaled NO, which is essentially nitroglycerin.
Yes, I'm sorry, inhaled NO.
Right. Okay. Now, we'll quickly close with the final two studies. One was the MITOCARE study, which was looking, again, at an agent that was designed to prevent reperfusion injury. In this case, it was targeting the mitochondrial pore that is one of the last steps before there's complete metabolic collapse in the cell. This was a completely negative study, despite initially some very promising animal results. And Mark, this is a repeated story where there are always intriguing results in animals about protection against myocardial damage. Hopefully these things would produce a reduction in infarct size. Completely negative study. Does that surprise you? The animal models didn't predict something in the patients.
It's disappointing, of course. When you do careful preclinical work and you have good basic science, you're hopeful that it will be translated into positive clinical outcomes in patients. Unfortunately, that was not the case here. Using this compound, which was hoped to prevent mitochondrial-mediated cell injury, it didn't work. And there was, again, no signal at all in terms of cardiac enzyme or looking at MRI, looking at infarct size, no benefit at all.
Okay. The last one is the Atlantic study, and this is kind of an intriguing study comparing the administration of ticagrelor, a P2Y12 antagonist, in the pre-hospital setting versus in the cath lab when PCI was done, primary PCI was done in patients with STEMI. Now, this report was from France, essentially from Paris, where there was a very rapid transport time, and there was only a median time difference of 31 minutes. They found that there was no difference in the amount of ST segment resolution comparing the pre-hospital versus in-hospital or in-cath lab group, but there was a very intriguing observation that there was a reduction in stent thrombosis favoring those who had received pre-hospital therapy. And a number of questions arose during the press conference, actually, which is, if this was a therapy that was tested in environments where the transport time was longer, would we see even more benefit of pre-hospital ticagrelor? What are your thoughts on that?
I like this study, Elliott. And even though it didn't meet its primary endpoint, this is a very important secondary endpoint, stent thrombosis. And the differences in the two groups were not trivial. This is 30-day stent thrombosis decreased from 1.2% to 0.2%. Mm-hmm. Now, whether that would have effect in cardiovascular outcomes as we look later, I don't know. But I'm particularly encouraged by that. that finding.
Stent thrombosis can be a devastating complication. It's essentially a reproduction of an ST elevation myocardial infarction and could be lethal for the patient. A number of very interesting studies. This is Elliott, Antman, and Mark Creager signing off for our AHA Science News here at the ESC Congress in Barcelona. Thank you for listening.